First, he told
it's a half an hour interview?
It's a half an hour interview. Wow, it's just
okay.
A chat.
Okay.
How did they drag you in?
How did they rope me in?
rope you in to be a chair of this event?
Well, you know, I was, I guess 5 or 6 years ago, Hawk Koch had called me up and he said, you got to join the Producers Guild. So I joined. He's a friend of mine and we've known each other for a long time. So I joined, and then the year after that, Gail Hurd said to me, she said, you got to get more involved with the Producers Guild. So the next thing I knew, I was on the Producers Council, and then I was voted, became one of the board of directors. And then a couple years ago, Mark Gordon and Hawk Koch were the new presidents, and they said, would you be vice president of motion pictures? So I said, yes. And this past year, Vance Van Patten came to me, and he said, you know, would you co-chair the Producers Conference? Because I've been an active in the Producers Guild, mm-hmm. and I enjoy the Producers Conference. And he said, you know, you won't have to do so much work. It'll be you and Tracy Edmonds and Marshall Herskovitz, but it's a lot of work. But it's fun, you know, and it's for a great organization.
So PGA has really kind of evolved in the last 5, 6, 7 years, yes?
Yes. Well, all of the people that are producers, that are struggling producers, or yeah, every producer is a struggling producer, you know, because even the rich ones are struggle yeah. getting movies made and getting them made well. You like being a part of it, and it's got a good purpose. You know, and this whole producer's mark thing is a very important thing. I've been in arbitrations before, and, you know, who's the real producer, who's the person who's not a real producer? Those are valuable and viable questions.
So if you are the real producer, you probably know the answer to the question.
Yes. Yes.
You just need to get it on paper somewhere.
Yeah.
Somehow.
Yes.
So you got into it. So it's a daily thing of trying to figure out what kind of programming you're going to
what happened this year is, you know, we've had some really good conferences. You know, we've had some big people, and we've got some really big people this year. But the good news is that this year we asked a lot of people to come, and they showed up. You know, so we have. You know, Christopher Nolan is one of the speakers, Brian Grazer is speaking, Michael Burns is speaking, hold on for a second.
You have a list.
I've got a list, especially some interesting ones from the world of tech. You know, from television we have Shonda Rhimes, and we've got Sally Ann Silsano, and we've got Bill Lawrence, and then we've got Robert Kinsel from Google, we've got Ross Levinson. We've got Ted Sarandos. You know, we've got a lot of people that are really at the cutting edge of the new technologies and the new media as well.
So your world is expanding.
Yes.
Whether you like it or not.
But it has to. To survive, we have to. I mean, I feel like I'm a duck. I try to be calm on top of the water, but my legs are moving as fast as they can. That's the way I look at my life.
Does the technology change everything?
Everything. Well, Kodak's out of business. How could it not have changed everything? Changed everything. I mean, we at Lakeshore, we own some Red cameras. We shoot digital. You know, we've been shooting that for 2 or 3 years. As a matter of fact, it's difficult getting film. You know, we have certain deals with foreign distributors where we have to deliver the movie in film.
Right.
It's hard finding the film. Hey. So people aren't making film anymore. So everything's digital, and that's the way it's going to go. And we've got big screens, small screens, medium screens.
So is that all good, do you think?
I think it's unavoidable. So I view whether it's good or bad as sort of irrelevant. It is a technological change. I mean, I think one could contend that we work in a business, the business of entertainment, that technology has always changed it. And 100 years ago changed it profoundly when Thomas Edison, you know, created the phonograph and created the movie camera, basically. I don't know if he created the movie camera, but films were created and audio sound was created. Because what happened at that point is that if you wanted to hear a good singer, you would go to a saloon, you'd go to a vaudeville place, you'd go to a show, and you'd hear the best local singer you could hear. But with technology, all of a sudden there was radio and phonographs, and you could hear the best singer in the world. Okay. All of a sudden, there was motion pictures, and you could see not only a great performer that was a local performer, you could see the most handsome guy who was the best performer, the most beautiful girl who was also a great performer. So technology created our business. So why are we so surprised that technology is asking our business to evolve once again?
So do you think a lot of people are afraid of it, or are people more pragmatic, like you seem to be?
I think both. I think a lot of people are afraid of it and are reluctant for change. But I don't know. I know myself. I know that I'm on my laptop constantly. I've got a laptop, mm-hmm. I've got a desktop, but I spend a lot of time on my laptop doing maybe not the same things as a 15-year-old kid would, if I were 15, right. would do. But you know, for me, it's communication, it's research, it's emails, it's reading your blog, it's reading news, it's being informed, it's being entertained. So if that's my experience with a new technology,
right.
and I'm 56, you know, what a young kid's going to have a profound experience with technology.
Does it change how you approach the kind of movies you want to make?
It makes me think constantly. It makes me think constantly about the movies. I think that, you know, there was a time where with our business, you could see the financial model very clearly. You know, we at Lakeshore, we pre-sell the international rights. They would usually bring us 75-80% of the negative cost, and then we could sell the domestic for 25%, and there would be no gap, and the studio would pay for the P&A, and those days have really gone. You know, you can still get a good chunk out of international, but the domestic minimum guarantees are low, and we have to find equity partners, and we have to figure out how to put up some of our own P&A, and that's just the norm for a company like the company that I work for.
So, I mean, you started the Underworld franchise.
Yes.
Around the same time as Million Dollar Baby.
The first Underworld was before Million Dollar.
It was before Million Dollar Baby. So, you know, Clint's pretty old school. And Underworld's pretty new school.
Well, we're you know, Lakeshore is a we're very universal in terms of our appetite. You know, we like staying young, so we like the Underworld franchise, and we did The Exorcism of Emily Rose, and we just have done this movie I, Frankenstein, which is a new Frankenstein myth that we hope is another Underworld franchise. So we'll do that. At the same time, we've done two Philip Roth movies. We did The Human Stain and Elegy, you know, which was Dying Animal. We did Million Dollar Baby. We've done heavier stuff. So we do both. That's who we are.
So what brought you into all of this in the first place? What was it? Did you want to get in the movie business when you were a kid?
No. I wasn't even aware of the movie business. I was I was a working class kid from San Francisco. I worked in a grocery store all through high school. My father drove a bread truck. I came from a close-knit middle class Italian American Irish mother family. And now that I look back at it, okay. Mm-hmm. My father, who was in the Army Air Corps in World War II, he was in a B-24 bomber, he was a waste gunner, okay? We had one of those families that, I would say, 5 out of the 7 nights of the week, the doorbell would ring at 6:30 and somebody would come over to our flat in San Francisco. Uh-huh. It would be one of my father's buddies that he was in the service with, and they'd sit around the table and they'd talk, and they'd tell stories, and they would drink their coffee royals with a coffee with a little whiskey in them, and they'd tell stories, and I was the kid that sat at the table listening to the stories. So now that I look back, that's what intrigued me. But I was a history major at UCLA in my senior year, about to go to law school, when I found myself taking a class. I didn't even take the class. I audited a class that David Geffen was teaching about the entertainment business. And it was the first time in my life that I actually encountered successful people. The people that I knew who were successful when I grew up owned restaurants. Okay, successful people owned restaurants. I didn't know. Mm-hmm. None of my friends' fathers were lawyers or businessmen. None of them. They owned restaurants. That was the most successful. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden, I was, you know, in this class, and I remember seeing Steve Ross and Sid Sheinberg and Ned Tannen and Mike Medavoy and, you know, the captains of the industry. And I raised my hand at the end of the class, and I said to David Geffen, I said, "Where do you go if you want to get into the business side of entertainment?" Mm-hmm. And he said, "Oh, that's very simple." He said, "Go to the William Morris Agency, start off in the mailroom, and work your way up." So I graduated from UCLA with my history degree. I applied to the William Morris Agency. One of the questions on the application was, "Who do you know in the entertainment business?" I wrote David Geffen. And a month later, they interviewed me. And I guess they liked the fact that, I don't know, I worked in a grocery store or something. Mm-hmm. You know, I put myself through college, you know, and they hired me. And I was completely fish out of water. But it turned out great. I ended up working for the head of motion pictures, a fellow by the name of Stan Kamen. And, you know, I was an agent at 24. And I love being an agent. I loved, you know, I've had various work experiences through my life, and I've enjoyed all of them.
Are you nostalgic?
Sure.
I mean, yeah. It's like hard to imagine something like the David Geffen class ever happening now. I mean, I guess the PGA event is kind of the closest thing you're going to get to it.
But I think that I think it happens all the time because, you know, I have two daughters that are both now out of university. But, you know, people sit around our dinner table and I'll tell crazy stories. I mean, there's a girl that is coming to work, back to work for us again. She went to high school with one of my daughters and she was at University of Santa Clara and she liked film, but she liked editing. You know, she said, I'm kind of interested in editing. And I said, well, I've got this book you should read. Okay, it's this book that Walter Murch wrote about editing. And I had worked with Walter Murch on Ghost and on one of the Godfather movies. And I said, you know, I'll tell you what. I said, if you read the whole book, you can keep it. Okay, if you don't read the whole book, then give it back to me. Mm-hmm. So she reads the book. She loves the book. So she becomes an editor at college. She wins some awards. She's now working in post-production on movies. So I don't think that that's that different an experience than from me sitting around listening to the old timers, you know, you know, when I was working for Stan Kamen, I got to meet Ray Stark. I got to meet people like that. They were characters, you know. Maybe there's not as many big characters in Hollywood today as there were 25 years ago, but there's still some people that'll tell you a good story.
Well, we say there's no way to do Battle of the Network Stars, of course, a classic TV show,
right?
On ABC,
right?
Now, because personal publicists would never allow it,
and right?
Probably the same thing's true with moguls, is that everything is a little more controlled than it used to be. It seems like
right, probably a little more, but we do have, as a matter of fact, we do have. Wait a second, what the hell is this? Larry Gordon is doing a thing at the Produced By conference, so you'll hear some great old stories there.
Yeah.
I mean, Larry's been...
Larry Gordon's always good for a story.
Yeah, he's been through the fire.
Yes, he has. Well, that seems like that's kind of like, for me, from outside of it, feels kind of like what these PGA Produced By conferences are almost, that's part of the experience, is just being in the high school with the other kids.
Yeah, well,
let
me tell you something. I've had assistants that have gone the past couple of years. I told them they had to go and I bought a ticket for them. Mm-hmm. They've loved it because there's really something for everyone. You know, there are intriguing panels on film, there's intriguing panels on television, there are intriguing panels on new media, there are intriguing panels on marketing, on going green, and then there are interviews with Mark Cuban, with Michael Burns, with, you know, Larry Gordon, with interesting people that have something to say, you know. And by the way, I would venture to say that Most of the thinking will, most of the questions and most of the experiences that people have. You know, like when Christopher Nolan's talking, he's probably talking about Batman. He's probably talking about his thoughts about the future.
Right.
I think everybody's talking about the future. You know, what their crystal ball is telling them about what kind of movies to make, how to get them made, what's the shortcut to get it done. You know, who should you cast? How do you finance something internationally? Everybody's talking about the future. They're not talking about, well, they may say, I did this in the past, but they're going to say, this is what I'm doing now. You know, so that's always informational. There's something for everybody at this conference.
Does PGA have a role, you think, in leading into the future as to what choices are made?
Well, they've taken that role. And I think that, you know, producers are the ones that do put it all together. You know, now there are producers that get money from studios, but they still have to package that product. They still have to find the idea, find the writer, find the director, find the star, kiss the ass of the person that's going to give them the money. You know, in the independent world, you have to do all of those things, including finding the money and going to which territory will you get more money from? Can you go to Canal Plus? Will you go to Germany? Is there a Japanese component? Is there a Chinese component? What is China right now? Mm-hmm. So, you know, those are the things that will be discussed and you know, everybody's gonna try to figure out at this conference.
Did you know what China is right now?
No. Here's what I know. I know that Men in Black did $20 million there, so that's big. Yeah. I know that when I speak to some of the Chinese people I know, they all tell me that nothing's going to happen this year until November because there are new elections and everything will change. Mm-hmm. So, but clearly the studios are paying attention. You know, CAA has an office there. Warner Brothers has a presence there. Sony has a presence there. They've got, 2 billion people. And they probably are people who haven't seen a lot of film, so may find it absolutely fascinating. Well, how can we... accommodate their willingness?
Well, my experience was, I was there about 10 years ago,
right.
And my experience was just buying every movie possible on the street for, you know, 10 yuan.
Right.
You know, it was like a buck a movie, less than a buck a movie
right.
for everything. And now, you know, there weren't very many screens.
Right.
There weren't
right.
the option of seeing things on a screen.
Right.
I mean, I think I bought a movie and then saw it on this, it was, I think, Gladiator.
Right.
That summer, maybe. It was, you could buy it in the street or you could buy it in the theater for,
right.
you know, six times as much.
Right, right.
But they seem to be extremely, it's a lot of money there.
Right.
It's not like, you know, there's a poor community in a lot of ways.
Right.
But they seem to be willing to go in huge numbers.
Right. And there's big money in certain places, too. I think Shanghai and Beijing still has, you know,
yeah.
big money.
So are you interested in the exhibition business?
I don't know. It hasn't crossed my mind, but it doesn't mean that I shouldn't be. What do you mean by exhibition business?
Just that it seems like the studios and everybody's kind of getting now that we don't have to worry about the consent decree so much anymore, people seem to be doing everything. People seem to be expanding out and trying. You know, the studios are being are building theaters overseas. You know, this whole world is becoming smaller, and people are kind of expanding the width of what they do.
I had one crazy idea about exhibition, but that was a more of a four wall situation. It's a cool idea, so I
should keep it to yourself.
Yeah, I'll keep it to myself.
Is your job to keep your nose to the ground and stay focused on the things that you are completely focused on, or is it to view the entire world at the same time, or do you have to do both?
Well, no, my job is to put movies and television product together for Lakeshore Entertainment, and primarily movies, okay? That's
right.
really what my job is. But I think that, you know, because we do have an international sales company as part of Lakeshore, and we sell our movies to foreign territories, you have to be aware of what's going on in the world.
Well, that's kind of was part of the foundation
right.
of the company.
Right? Absolutely.
So that business is still as important as it was
absolutely.
5 years ago.
Sure, absolutely.
So are there other major trends coming through that are shaking things up at this point, do you think?
Well, I think that for a film producer, you mean, or for mm-hmm. a producer like myself, I think the thing that we have to ask ourselves is what really is a motion picture theatrical experience right now?
Mm-hmm.
I think that there are... to me, there's certainly, we know that there's spectacle, we know that there's comedy, we know there's horror, and I think dramas have to be, you know, done, executed at the highest level. And we have to be fiscally responsible, but that's always been easy for Lakeshore. We'll take a lot of creative risks, you know, we'll make The Human Stain, we'll make Million Dollar Baby, but we make them at the right prices. We don't take huge financial risks, you know. You allow the directors to make the best movie they can, but you don't sit there and, you know, nobody, a lot of times we're in two bangers instead of
right.
big, huge motorhomes. I mean, we eat just as well as anybody else on the set, but, you know, half the time you're not even in these big trailers. So
right.
we're not about that sort of largesse, but we're very thoughtful and very prudent.
Did you ever want to float down that river?
Float down which
river? Of having too much of
I worked at an agency,
then I worked at
studios, and the studios there was more, but there's certainly more creativity where I am right now, and more flexibility and more responsibility too. So you know, I'm just pounding the pavement trying to put more movies together.
And how would you say PGA fits in with the whole group of unions/guilds? In the world at this point? I mean, obviously you guys aren't negotiating as a group.
No,
at this
but we're
point.
We're not a union, you know, and I guess we're prohibited from being a union. Vance Van Patten can talk more about that, but
yeah.
We're a guild. We're a body of people that speak with a pretty powerful voice, but don't have the same sort of, because many of us are hired by the studios, don't have the same union abilities
right.
that the writers and the directors have, or the actors.
Would you have embrace of them? Do you have a sense of like being part another
sure.
piece of that?
Yeah, well, we're now over 5,000 members, so we're a pretty significant bunch, and we certainly determine the credits for the awards. So that's for the producing credits, which is
mm-hmm.
you know one could argue one of the most important credits that one could have is best picture or best best comedy, best drama. In television.
And do people know what you do at this point when you tell them you're a producer?
Most of the time you have to define it, but you can say, look, you know, if you're building a building, you're some of us are architects and some of us are contractors, but we're basically designing and making the building, mm-hmm. you know, in many respects. We may not be pounding the nails, but we have oversight over it. So I think when you discuss it in those terms, people understand. But if I meet somebody on an airplane and I say I'm a movie producer, they say, well, what does a producer really do? And you say, well, you see this book that you're reading? I might option the book, and then I'd find a writer to write the screenplay. And then if the screenplay is good, I'll find the actors, and then I'll find the money. And then we'll hire all those people. And then I'm sitting on the set, and all these people are doing their stuff, and I'm sitting there in a chair, and I'm making sure they do it right. You know, and my name's on the picture is produced by.
Right. And what part of it keeps you the most excited at this point after all these years doing it?
There's a moment that there's a moment that I love, which is when you have the script and you know that if you get that director or actor or combination of the two, that you can see the movie's going to get made. I really like that moment. I like that moment where it goes from a yellow light to a green light. That still very much excites me. And then there are three nervous moments I've always felt. The first day of shooting, mm-hmm. even though you may think you know the people that you're working with, you don't quite know. So there's a call the first day, the first two or three days. Uh-huh. That's always a little bit nervous making. The first time you see the cut of the movie, that's nervous. and then when the movie gets released, you know you're either ecstatic or you're okay or you're despondent, you know.
And
I've experienced all three.
Does it go away at some point, or are you still, I mean, walking through your office, there all the posters are still there, and you have to be reminded every day of every movie you made, it feels like.
You remember them, and then there are times that you look back and you say, God, did I really do that? I don't know. You know, people say, oh, you made, I don't know, almost 50 movies or something. It's hard to fathom. You know, I don't see myself that way. I don't live in the past at all. My wife mm-hmm. tells me, she said, you don't live in the past. I live in the present and in the future. And I'm still challenged every day.
So do you measure by your happiness, or do you measure by the number of rewards on the shelf, or?
My life? I'll tell you, I had an experience the other day that I felt really good about, okay? Mm-hmm. And this is just me. This is a Gary Lucchesi story. This is nobody else, right? I had a meeting with an actress, and it was an actress that had come from sort of a broken home and didn't have a good relationship with her father. And she talked about how, you know, she'd had a business manager, an agent, who said to her when she was young, you know, I'll watch out for you, I'll take care of you, you can come to me with anything. You know, you can come talk to me, I'll always be there for you. And then the person failed, okay? And she said she'd experienced that two or three times in her life, okay? And I thought about my daughters, okay? And if somebody said to them, you know, I'll look out for you, I'll take care of you, you can come to me with anything, they kind of look at them and say, I got that handled, I don't need that. You know, because they have a father. So I felt, when I heard that story, I thought, my daughters will never have to look to some guy to be their father figure, because they had a guy who talks to them, who is their father figure. So that actually made me feel happy.
You sound actually sane when you talk about
real life. But you know, look,
this business, I mean, it's funny because the perception of, I think, on the outside versus the people who actually go to work every day, different.
Well, here's the people. Here's what the public doesn't know about Hollywood. Most of the people in Hollywood don't come from a lot of money. Most of the people in Hollywood work their asses off to make a life for themselves and have struggled to maintain it. And by and large, enjoyed much of it. You know, my children who are kind of working in Hollywood right now, I feel like they're doing that because there were too many nights I came home for dinner and I said, you won't believe what happened today, okay? And I think for a young kid, they sit there and they say, your father says, you won't believe what happened today. They think that that's exciting. But I think most of Hollywood is actually very sane, very hardworking, more moderate than people choose to believe. You know, even politically, I think most of us are social liberals. But I think most of us, we don't want to give our money away to any, you know, we don't have all that money to give. You know, most of us are fiscal conservatives and social liberals in Hollywood. Most of us are really sane. And by the way, most of the actors that you might think that they're eccentric, or they've worked their asses off. They've been rejected millions of times, okay? And then finally, they got a little bit lucky and they made some money, and and they have the same struggles that you and I do. They want to raise their children well. They don't want their children to be spoiled. They want them to be, you know, good citizens, good Americans. That's what we want.
It's hard work.
It is.
It's not an. It's a business. The rewards are enormous when it works out, but it's very, very hard work.
But they're not as enormous as if you were in a lot of other businesses. I mean, a guy's made a lot more money probably in real estate or in tech right now.
That's true.
We're a mature business, I think, but if we're it's still exciting because it's creative.
Well, the internet's keeping us young.
Yes,
whether we like it or not. So when your event comes about, when you actually have your day.
Yeah, it's next weekend. It's the 8th, 9th, and
10th.
8th, 9th, and 10th.
Will you be nervous for your opening? Will it feel like you're opening
I just want to make sure that people show up, okay? I just want to make sure that, I mean, we've sold out the past few years. We feel like we're going to sell out again. You know, we have probably as good a group of people as we've ever had. And I just want people to show up. Because I think if people show up, I know they're going to have a good time. I know they're going to feel well-informed. We're on the Sony lot, which is a very easy lot for mm-hmm. people to get around. So that's comfortable. And this produced by conference was really a dream of Gail Hurd's and this woman, Rachel Klein. Rachel Klein's one of the co-chairs this year, too. And mm-hmm. and Gail was the one who had the real balls to... Mm-hmm. to tell everybody we should do it. I remember I was on the producers council, I don't think I was a board of directors that first year. We were scared, you know, going into that first weekend. And, you know, she asked...
Just about whether anybody would show up or...
Whether a lot of people would show up. You know, the ticket sales are always mixed and then they happen in the last week. And I remember that year we had James Cameron and Clint Eastwood spoke and it was great.
So it worked out.
It worked out. And it worked out the second year and it worked out the third year and God willing, it'll work out the fourth year, and you know, next year there'll be somebody else who'll be a co-chair. But
I'll take a year off. You'll go and you'll have a good time.
I'll go.
Do you go? Is it like you're going to a high school reunion when you go, or is it?
No. I'll show up and I'll see all these people, and I'll say, "Boy, I don't know a lot of people here," you know. And
you don't know every single person in show business.
And then I'll be a part of. I'm doing two panels. I'm interviewing Michael Burns, which I'm looking forward to. And then I'm doing a mentoring one, so there'll be some young people who sit around and they'll want to hear how to become a producer, and I'll tell them to create something that's small and really commercial.
You're not going to tell them to go to work at William Morris?
Well, that's not the worst thing in the world, by the way. I had a great time when I was an agent.
Well, that was where everybody kind of came out of. I don't know if that's still the case or not.
I think for somebody who isn't born into Hollywood, and I think it's a fantastic place. The agencies are great. I loved being an agent. I didn't feel it was my destiny, but I didn't resent it, or didn't regret it one bit. I mean, there are times that you say, you know, tell me about a fascinating dinner you had. Well, I represented Susan Sarandon, and I was at her house, and it was me and Susan Sarandon and Leonard Bernstein. Mm-hmm. I mean, how bad is that? You know, and her husband at the time, Franco Amore, was making pasta, and he knew Leonard Bernstein. They called him Lenny, you know, and he was drinking scotch, and I was drinking wine. And he was talking about how he was struggling, he had, you know, composer's block. That was an interesting dinner. You know, so, I mean, there's that's my life, that's my experience.